So this is a quick demonstration of the lumbar vertebrae. Let's take a quick look at the parts. We can see that this is a huge structure in the front. This is the vertebral body. The lumbar vertebra has got the largest body because it's weight-bearing, and that's one of its main functions, weight-bearing. This is the vertebral foramen, and this, when all the vertebrae are united together, it forms a vertebral canal, which gives passage to the spinal cord. And the posterior portion of the vertebral foramen, this whole thing, composite mass, is called the vertebral arch. The vertebral arch has got certain special processes. One is the central one, and that is known as the spinous process. This is formed by the fusion of the two laminae to form the spinous process. Then we have these two lateral projections called the transverse processes. And we have this projection going up and down. These are the superior and inferior articular facets, also called the zygapophysis. The small space in between the superior and inferior, this region is referred to as the pars interarticularis. Take a look at the articular facet, the superior one. If you look at the articular, the direction of the facets, they are in the sagittal plane. This is in contrast to the articular facet of the thoracic vertebra, which was in a coronal plane. So this sagittal articular facets allow the flexion and extension mobility of the lumbar spine. And that is the reason why the T12, the upper facet, is in the coronal plane, the lower facet is in the sagittal plane, because the T12 has to articulate with L1 below. Okay, so this is the significance of the articular facet and the mobility. The portion which attaches the arch to the vertebral body, this is referred to as the pedicle. This peripheral portion of the body is made of cortical bone, and that is known as the epiphyseal rim. It is derived from the annular epiphysis. And the central larger portion is the spongy bone, which is derived from the central. So these are the salient parts of a typical vertebra and a lumbar vertebra. Let's take a look at some of the clinical correlations pertaining to the lumbar vertebra. Because it's weight-bearing, it is subjected to maximum stresses and strains. In old age, especially in females, this can undergo osteoporosis or osteopenia, and it can lead to compression or wedge compression fracture. Spontaneously, it can happen. New bone formation can take place at the articular facets and the margins, and that is known as osteophytes. It is a type of degenerative osteoarthritis. Similarly, new bone formation can reduce the space in the vertebral foramen, that is known as lumbar stenosis, and can produce spinal cord compression. And if there is a significant spinal cord compression, which we will diagnose with CT scan, MRI, or lumbar myelogram, then we will have to do what is known as a laminectomy. There are two ways of doing it. We can either cut at the pars interarticularis and thus open the space, or we can cut the pedicle. In either situation, we open up the space and reduce the compression. So that is the process for laminectomy, which is done in the case of lumbar spine. This is a picture to show a lumbar myelogram and a lumbar stenosis. Thank you very much for watching. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal, signing out.